So hopefully this will be entertaining. I've got my coffee, as I'm sure everybody else does. I want to just kind of get some of the boring stuff out of the way. They wanted me to include a slide about myself. I am the director of security at HealthStream. So I am based out of Nashville. We do primarily healthcare training. So any of your most of the people that are in that work in hospitals have to go kind of undergo yearly compliance training to make sure that they have all their skills up to date. And we provide the learning management system for them to do that. I've been in the security field for about 15 years in different roles. I've worked in application security, cloud security, started a few security departments at my previous role, and really working on building the one out at HealthStream where I'm currently at. I have a training on LinkedIn if anybody is interested on the DevSecOps and how you can apply that from an application security perspective. I have a training on Lynda or LinkedIn training that you guys could check out. And for the most part, I've been focused on AppSec for many years. But over the last couple of years, I've really started to focus on cloud security and container security. I think most people probably in the room have seen some of the shift over to cloud, some of the shift over to containers. And one of the things that I found as I start talking about containers with people, especially some security people, is in general, we don't really understand what's the real problem with security in containers. You know, so the containers may not live that long. Containers are just really these miniature little buckets. What do we really have to worry about security with containers? Kind of on top of that, typically containers are part of an overall DevOps process, right? So the process happens very quickly. The containers are created as a part of code. So how can we in security not only care about it, but how can we make sure we can keep up with the pace of development? So I want to take some time and kind of walk through each of these. So for everybody that doesn't know, I think probably most people do know, I guess, if you're here, but this is kind of an example of what a container looks like. It looks a little bit different from our normal application stack where you've got a server that runs Tomcat, and then you have a server that runs a database, and maybe you have, you know, two or three different servers that comprise an application. And the point of a container is you have everything containerized. You have your application, your libraries, your operating system, like everything in one little bucket, right? And so from a security perspective, there are different ways to approach it. So I kind of I try and break it down into three primary places where we should look and care about security of a container. And there are others, but these are the primary areas of focus that I look at it. So application and library, application security and library security. So these are the actual application that is running on your container and the libraries that support them. And by libraries, I mean jar files, open source software that maybe your application uses, all of that part that actually makes up the application. I won't touch on the application security as much in this presentation, because application security in one place, for the most part, is similar. But I will touch on the library security a little bit, because a lot of the container security tools out there really put a big focus on that. The next part that we'll talk about a little bit is the actual configuration of your container engine. And in this case, sometimes I say Docker, but substitute Docker for whatever your container engine is. And so the configuration of your Docker, your Kubernetes, or what have you. And then overall, we actually have to have a host that actually runs all of your containers, right? So you have to be concerned about the security of your overall host. So kind of breaking these down a little bit more, for everybody that, like I said, I've been living and breathing application security for a while, so I don't want to assume that everybody is as familiar with it as I am, but back in 2013, libraries inside of applications were considered enough of an issue that the OWASP actually created their own category for them. So they're the A9 as part of OWASP. And what that means is there's a security concern that as we use libraries in our applications, we forget about them and we never update them, right? And so they get old over time. There are CVEs and vulnerabilities that come out about them, and we just kind of forget about them. So outdated libraries is actually its own OWASP item inside of the OWASP top 10. And you don't have to look any further than this as an example than Equifax and Struts, right? So that's the perfect example of why libraries are important, right? It's a very common library that's used everywhere. There's a major hole in it that had to be patched fairly quickly. Otherwise, you would be subject to something like happened with Equifax. They're really easy to miss in containers. And so, like I mentioned before, sometimes containers are just this blob of things that developers end up making, right? In theory, they're supposed to be all code, and maybe, you know, we don't have a server that's set up where we can scan with our Black Duck or our source code scanner, right, as easily. So they're really easy to miss with containers, and a lot of our traditional security tools don't work with containers. Kind of going on to the next step here, so the Docker configuration. So sometimes people forget that the actual Docker engine itself is, I'm sorry, the actual configuration of it. So if you don't configure Docker correctly, just like anything else, it can have security holes. And so going back to the OWASP top 10, number six is misconfiguration, right, of your Tomcat, of your IIS, and Docker would fall into this as well. So if you don't have Docker configured correctly and locked down, you can have a vulnerable instance of Docker running. And it's such an important part these days. Like, if you guys are familiar with the Center for Internet Security, hopefully they have, you know, they publish standards for any of the servers that are out there. They publish standards for, you know, IIS, Tomcat, Apache, and you can buy them, or the actual documents are available for free. But they actually have benchmarks for Docker as well. So it's one of the things that's becoming more and more popular. And then finally, the host security. So I think the easiest way from a security professional to think about the overall host security is like with the VMware. Back when we were doing, we've been concerned about VM escape for a while now. So if anybody knows about virtual machine escape and the possibility to have a vulnerability in VMware and then kind of go from one VM to another on the back end, the same type of thing can happen with the host of Docker, right? So you have to be concerned about, can container A get over to container B? Can a hacker break out of one container and then kind of pivot east to west over to the other containers that are on your host, right? So you have to be aware, and I call it container escape. Whether that's an official term or not, I don't know, but it's kind of what it is, escaping one container and moving your way over to another container. And then finally, Docker uses ports just like servers. So you have to be concerned with which ports your containers are listening on, right? So do you have port 22 open or 21 open? Did you mean to do that? So you really have to be concerned with that. So, and I come back to this, and I mentioned it at the very beginning. One big thing we need to talk about is that we kind of have to think a little bit different, right? We have to be faster. And containers typically go along with DevOps and with CI/CD. So before I talk about how to integrate our container testing with CI/CD, I kind of want to talk a little bit about DevOps and then kind of make my way into CI/CD, and then we'll see some examples of some tools that are on the market that we can use and how the overall flow of integrating this into your pipeline would work, right? So when I do a fair amount of talks, especially locally around DevOps, and I find that sometimes we don't have a great understanding of what DevOps actually is, and maybe everybody here has went to every DevOps session and you guys have this nailed, right? But I think it's important to know what it is and what it isn't. So I found this quote from an AWS blog, and it says, it's a combination of cultural philosophies, practices, and tools that increases an organization's ability to deliver applications and services at high velocity, okay? What it isn't is an alternative to Agile. And what it isn't is it's not an alternative to Waterfall, right? DevOps is really a culture change, okay? So when you talk about DevOps, it's changing the entire way that you develop an application. It's changing the way that you, as a company, do your IT work, in essence, right? So it's taking your developers, it's taking your testers, it's taking your operational folks, and it's putting them all together to work on one platform. So you don't have all these separate teams anymore. You have one team that handles it all. They handle the development, they handle the testing, they handle the operations, the support. All of that kind of stuff is really together in one team. And so, like I said, it's an overall culture change. It's not really a different type of development methodology, because typically Agile and DevOps go hand in hand. And the overall goal, we wouldn't do this if there were no goal, right? So the overall goal is to reduce the cycle time, make your builds daily, weekly, do change a lot quicker. Okay, so that changes security, right? So one of the problems that we have as security people is keeping up sometimes with what developers and production support people want to do. They want to continually move faster. We've been the long pole in the tent sometimes with not being able to move as quickly. So that really forces us to have to look at ourselves as security professionals and change how we look at it when we go into containers, when we go into DevOps, all right? We've got to be more accurate and flexible in our testing. And also, I pose out here that it actually shifts the responsibility away from us to some extent over to developers. And what I mean by that is, the title of this presentation is Container Security at the Speed of CI/CD. And so the purpose of it is to take the container security, the scanning, and the testing of containers, and move that responsibility over to developers. Put it in their pipeline so that we're not the ones that are sitting here running containers through a tool. We're not the ones looking, heads down inside of a tool looking at the security of a container. We have provided the developers an opportunity to integrate the security testing inside of their process, and that onus is not on us, right? So that's what I mean by shifting responsibility. And I'm big into saying that it kind of, to some extent, changes my team's job and your job maybe more to auditors rather than hands-on testers, right? That's kind of the overall goal that I have as I move my team over into a DevOps sort of mindset. So like I mentioned, that's when DevSecOps enters the picture. So that's, we take the incorporate the security principles into DevOps. So we take our application security testing and we move that over into DevOps and we figure out how to do that quickly. It makes the developers responsible for security. So we will still be accountable, right? It's still ultimately our tail on the line if something goes out that hasn't been tested. But the developers are responsible for doing it. They're the ones that have to integrate it into their process. And it moves us over to being auditors or SMEs, subject matter experts, so that they can come to us and ask us for help. But once again, we won't be the ones actually clicking a go on the tool. And it, like I said, it's really a shift in culture. And this seems to be one of the things that's hardest is us, security professionals used to getting in there and clicking buttons and all of that to learn how to do. And so that's kind of my two cents on DevOps and DevSecOps. And then what is CI/CD? So, sometimes these acronyms can mean different things. The CD means a couple of different things, but for the purposes of what we're going to talk about, it'll be continuous deployment. So the idea here, and I think everybody's probably seen this infinity loop. I've seen it at least twice in different presentations this week, but it basically means it's a continuous loop of testing, right? You build, you deploy into your integration environment, you test, you deploy to production, and you come back, and it's a continuous loop that always happens. And you can do this once a day, many times a day, whatever you choose as a part of your life cycle. Okay, so this is kind of the idea behind continuous integration and continuous deployment, all right? So continuous integration, your developer, when they're done doing their code, they have automated check-ins. As soon as the check-ins happen, the code is deployed into the integration environment. As soon as the code is deployed in the integration environment, the automated tests are usually next. Once the automated test passes, if you do true continuous deployment, you'll move into production after if your tests pass. And CD usually goes with CI. And so the key to a lot of this is automation. The most common one, with the example that I'm going to show you, is with Jenkins, right? That's kind of the most common automation that I've seen in my roles. And so kind of coming back, to this same slide. So now let's take a look a little bit about how we solve the problem for CI/CD with containers, right? So I'm breaking this down again into the different container security parts. I tried to think of a way that, this is the way that I think of it when I'm doing container security testing, and it seemed to make sense to me, so I put pen to paper here. So the one thing that we're gonna look for is vulnerabilities. Which libraries are out to date? Which ones have open CVEs? Which ones are just stale? We're gonna take that as one thing that we're gonna look for in the container security. The next thing we're gonna look at is the overall policies, right? So that's kind of step two is, are we actually complying to the container best practices, the CIS benchmarks? Are we doing silly things like putting keys in our container or running SSH or SSHD, things like that on our container that we shouldn't be? That's kind of the second thing that we're gonna look at. And then thirdly, we're gonna concentrate on runtime protection. We're going to talk about how to prevent container escape. Are there ways to do that and to protect when your container is running in production? And then we'll finally monitor for unusual activities on the container. And what that means is some of the container security tools that are out there will understand what's normal, right? If you've been running a container for a week or two and you've never had port 22 open, and all of a sudden one day SSH is running in the background, it's going to flag that as probably something malicious that's gotten installed and alert you to it. So look for unusual activities. So I figured the best way to kind of talk about it and show how this all fits into a CI/CD pipeline with Jenkins is to actually kind of show you some screenshots of some tools. And so I'm going to start with a tool called Twistlock. And I'm not here I don't own Twistlock is the one I'm most familiar with because we have owned it. But there are a couple, three different tools on the market. They're all good. I've heard good things about all of them, so I'm not really promoting one over the other. So we'll talk about Twistlock first, and then we'll go into Aqua. So this is kind of what it would look like here. So at this point, you've taken your container and you've hooked it into the container security tool. It scanned it, and this is what it shows you, right? It's going to show you all of the different vulnerable libraries that you have. And this, to me, is always the first step when you're getting CI/CD up and running. It's just, let's just start looking at the vulnerabilities and get a clean container and get a clean environment going. And this is where I always start. And so this is what it would look like. You can actually take it, and you can, if anybody's familiar with Jenkins, this is the plugins page from Jenkins. And so what you would do is you would come in here, you would add a plugin, put your Twistlock inside of a Jenkins integration. And then once you do, you would get something that looks like this. Every time that you run your build, whether that's several times a day, once a week, however often you do your build, then you would get a screen that looks like this that would tell you kind of what the security of your overall containers was. Okay. And the idea here was to look something like this. This is kind of a container security flow. So I'm used to having something closer that I can point at, but you have your developers over on the left that are actually doing all the coding. And then, like I said, however often their Jenkins jobs run, that's configurable, you would connect your Jenkins into your container security example. And this one, I actually show Anchor. Anchor is an open source alternative to Twistlock, but insert your tool here. It could be Twistlock, it could be Anchor, it could be Aqua, it doesn't really matter, right? And so your Anchor analyzer, your Twistlock analyzer, looks at the security of your container, and based on the rules that you have set up, it will either allow that build to go forward or it won't, okay? And that's kind of how all the automated security tools work, and that's how the unit tests work. If you breach a certain threshold inside of your Jenkins job, you have the ability to either to pass it or to fail it, right? And so in this case, what we would do is if we were checked in our Jenkins job and our container had a outdated vulnerable library that had existing CVEs against it, we would fail it, right? And we wouldn't allow it to go forward, and we would investigate it and see what we could do. If it's okay and everything is good, then boom, you continue and go on to run the rest of your automated tests and do your deploy as needed. So hopefully that logic makes sense. So kind of talking a little bit about the compliance. So that was the libraries. The next step that I always do when I'm kind of step two for me when I'm doing a container security, rolling it out, is to look for compliance. So we take we got our library straightened out. We're good there. The next step is I go into here, and we make sure that the Docker images are set up with the best practices. And so you can buy the CIS benchmarks. You can download them. Some tools, I'll show you an example, they actually have it built into them where they scan your container for CIS benchmarks inherently inside the tool itself. And then continually monitor for updates. So once again, you could, in essence, take the slide that I previously just showed you, and you could put the compliance things in here. So if they don't comply to the standards that you have set, then you could actually fail them. And so this is kind of a screenshot of of what that would look like. So you can see here, hopefully everybody can see that. These are just some different compliance rules that are set up. I can't see it very well, but making sure Docker's up to date, making sure Linux is patched and up to date. There's just a bunch of different compliance rules that you can set up for your Docker containers. And if they're good and they pass, then you can let your container build and continue on. And then finally, and this is the one that I think that I do at the very end. It's part of your continuous monitoring. It's kind of the last part of your deployment. Is when you actually look at the runtime security of your containers on a host. So you're looking for some specific things here while the containers are running in production. You're looking for container escape. You're looking to make sure that container A isn't talking to container B. If they're supposed to talk to each other, then that's a normal thing, then you can set up firewall rules to allow that. But you want to make sure that you're looking for kind of unusual, strange activity. The next thing is unusual open ports. So these could be ports that the container security tool is going to be like, you don't need to be running port 22 on here. Why are you doing this? Or it could be ones that all of a sudden open up unexpectedly that have never been there before. And the other thing that it will look at is data being exfiltrated. So sometimes we don't think about a bunch of data being taken off our containers, but they just like anything else. A container could be owned. We could get some sort of a virus or intruder on it that starts exfiltrating the data of our SQL Server container. So this is kind of what that, in essence, would look like. So in Twistlock, you have a screen that looks like this, and you can see these are just some examples of some demos that we had set up here. But you can see it's going to show you. Looks like you got a hijack process. This isn't something. It looks like you got a hacker that has taken over. This doesn't look right. Or you can see that you're getting port scanned, or you got lateral movement going from container A to container B. We definitely want to stop that. So these are some things that they'll look at in runtime. And so here, what you would do, obviously, this is not something that you could fail in your Jenkins job. It's not part of the build process. But what you would do here is integrate this into your normal SIM, right? So this is something that you would have, just like anything else, monitoring for unusual activity. So this would hook up to your SIM and be alerted to your SOC. So the last thing that I'll show you here is Aqua. So I'll show you kind of the same thing, just with a different tool. And I will mention, for anybody that's just kind of starting out, I mentioned Anchor with an E. They're actually an open source container security tool. So if you guys are just wanting to play before making any sort of an investment in container security, Anchor is completely free. It's A-N-C-H-O-R-E. And you can download it, and it's all command line driven. So hopefully you're familiar with command line. If you want a GUI, you got to pay the enterprise license. But and we use that very successfully at my previous job when I was working at Nielsen. And we integrated it with Jenkins, and it worked great for monitoring the libraries. It doesn't do any of the runtime stuff. It doesn't do any of the Docker best practices. You'd have to find another way to do that. But it does a great job with the actual libraries. So just kind of looking at the second tool, I'll show you kind of the same things. This is what it would look like looking for out your libraries. So you can see some here are good, some here are bad. And it would work exactly the same way, right? So you would integrate Aqua with your Jenkins automation, just like anything else, and pass it or fail it. And this is kind of an example of Jenkins with Aqua. You can see here that the scans happened. You got your app scanner that's kind of popped out there, and you can see. So it works exactly the same way. This was something that I thought was pretty cool. That was a little bit of a differentiator that I saw between Aqua and Twistlock, was they actually have the CIS benchmarks integrated with their tools. So you can come in here and look and see if your container security is aligning to the best practices with CIS. Here, this is showing you kind of some runtime protection. So it's allowing you to set up firewall rules to know that, all right, I've got this image, it's a MongoDB container, and I know here are the things that I'm going to allow to run on the container, and you can specifically say these are the things that are whitelisted and it shouldn't be talking to A or B. And this is where you can set that up for your runtime protection. And then this is your firewall policies, where you can allow containers to talk to each other here. So that's pretty much it. But kind of the steps that I took, I know I mentioned it before, but what I did, so the first thing that I did was just found a team that was using a container inside of my organization and found somebody who was willing to work with me. That's the way I always start with something, is find a team that's willing to give you a hand. And start maybe simple. Start with start with Anchor, the free one, and just play around with it and see if you can get that integrated into Jenkins. And if it is something that you guys, if it works well for you guys and you want to go to the next step, then maybe look at one of the commercial alternatives, like an Aqua or a Twistlog. And then the 3 months after that, identify a tool that you want to continue to use. So if Anchor works well for you and you just want to keep working, you know, with the free tool, use it. If you think that it would be worth your time to invest in an overall container security tool, do that. And then kind of work to identify a process of how you would integrate it into your development and deployment pipeline. I showed you kind of the screenshot of how we did it with Jenkins. But start simple. That's always my advice, is don't start by trying to do the runtime, the best practices, and the vulnerabilities all at one time. What we learned after talking with some of the people on the commercial side was, you know, just start a little bit at a time. So start with your vulnerabilities first. Those are the easiest ones to knock out and get it to the point where you can fail your builds if they try and deploy a vulnerable library. After that, go to the Docker best practices and start there, and then fail the build for that. And then finally work on getting your runtime protection right, your firewall rules tuned, integrated into the SIM, and get that all working. And then within 6 months, continue to roll out to other projects, and then roll the entire thing out to your CI/CD process for containers. So that is what I have. I'll open it now for any questions.